The Dana Show.
I'm sorry. Actually, I'm not sorry. I'm not sorry at all.
If you knew the shows that I turned down in order to speak to you, you would be very impressed with yourself, Dana. That I can tell you.
Delivering the truth.
Are you a citizen or are you a subject? Because I'm a citizen, and I'll ask whatever question I want to whenever I want to. If you're a subject, you go on and you be a subject. I'm a citizen.
The Dana Show.
Well, you got to worry about a nominee who is so attracted to the old Soviet Union years ago that he and his wife went on a honeymoon to Moscow during the Cold War. He's the real deal. But what bothers me more is all the rest of them sound very similar. They just don't describe themselves as socialists. Some of them call themselves moderates. If the definition of a moderate in the Democratic presidential primaries these days is they're not for Medicare for all, but they're for the public option. The public option means there'll only be one insurance company pretty soon. So you're all headed in the same direction, socialized medicine.
Well, there you have it. As Mitch McConnell was talking about Bernie Sanders, he's going to end up, I don't know. I think, although everyone's now been suggesting that it could actually go to a brokered convention, it's still too early. We're not going to have any idea of that until after Super Tuesday. Can we stop? The only reason that there's all this speculation is because people have airtime to fill, and they have to talk, and they have to just keep, well, let's go down this path and go down. I hate doing that. Because it's not going to happen. Why am I going to sit here and tickle your butts with all this other stuff that may or may not happen? Happy Valentine's Day to you. I'm Dana Lash. For this romantic edition of The Dana Show, we have all kinds of stuff. We have Mike Bloomberg, which I don't think that I spent more time thinking about this topic on the rundown than the others. And magically, I didn't put it down. It's in my head. I expect Kane and Rachel and Steve to be in my physical head and to just know what I'm thinking like a cloud. You know, like it's a Google Doc, and it doesn't work out that way. So for this romantic edition of the Dana Show Valentine's Day, we're going to discuss Michael Bloomberg trying to send the black community a Valentine about stop and frisk. Yeah, he will. I bet that he actually would send something like that. Let me stop and frisk you. All right. So we got a lot of stuff to get into. We're going to get the 2020, the latest with William Barr. Later on, Andy McCarthy is going to join me. And I like Andy McCarthy because he's no nonsense. And I love it when he gets flummoxed because I think that he's able to roll his eyes verbally and in writing harder than anybody I've ever met. And that's a talent that I really admire. He's going to join us later because of all of the everything with William Barr. So yesterday, legit as we were getting ready to, well, it was probably on our third hour, this interview with ABC that William Barr gave came out, and he was discussing how, in his mind, it just, Trump's tweeting makes it difficult. And have you seen, I'm going to pull up some of these headlines because I have some of these. Have you seen, by the way that the media has been characterizing it? So, the way that I have seen it discussed is that the first headline I saw was Barr slams Trump, Barr blasts Trump, Barr blows up Trump narrative. They're all these like very explosive-y active verbs. When really legit all he said was, it's not helpful. I mean, it's the most low-key thing that somebody could say. And I honestly don't think it's a big deal what he said. The Trump White House was asked about this, and they're like, yeah, we don't care. We just don't care. So I in thinking on this, I don't care either. So what? But William Barr, the Trump administration was not getting involved or they weren't inserting themselves in this. This was William Barr realizing that the sentence was ridiculous. And I guess everyone thinks that he's ridiculous and dumb and not an intelligent person, that he wouldn't see this and already make a request or what he did was offer a suggestion, which, as I discussed yesterday, was totally within his purview as AG to do. We're going to get into that because I don't think Trump's going to stop tweeting about it. I really don't. We'll get into the latest with this situation with Andy McCabe. He's the former FBI official. He's the guy who authorized the investigation into all of this with all based this witch hunt. And so the United States, the government's closed the case against him. So that's done. There's not going to be, you know, I don't know that what this case signifies is that they're not going to have any criminal charges against him. But I don't know if there are other ways. This is a question for Andy McCarthy. I don't know if there are other ways to go after Andy McCabe. But you can see why there are people who, when they look at the Roger Stone case and they say, okay, well, if the charge against Roger Stone, the big one, is that it's a procedural charge, that he wasn't honest with the FBI agents. Well, you have FBI agents that haven't been honest with the people who pay their salaries, the taxpayers. You have FBI agents like Andy McCabe, who, by the way, he lied. Not only did he lie, but he and James Comey's testimonies publicly did not, they contradicted each other. And I think that that's a pretty significant thing when you're discussing charging other people for the very same thing of which you were guilty. And this is why I do not at all begrudge any of these people, including myself, who have been raising, you know, eyebrows over the hardcore way that they've been going after Stone on all of this. So I mean, when you look at, let me pull some of this up. They're both, so, and consider this, because Michael Flynn is facing, and Stone both face jail time for less than what Andy McCabe did. Andy McCabe, first, there a couple of separate things. Andy McCabe lied under oath, and his testimony and Comey's testimony conflicted. This is an interesting story. I think this was AP. How FBI officials, when they were working through the conflicting information that they had gathered, they were trying to figure out who was leaking what to the media. And one of the agents asked McCabe in a sit-down meeting, quote, I need to know from you. Did you authorize this article? Were you aware of it? Did you authorize it? And then McCabe had replied, yes, I did. That's at least how the FBI had described his response. But he had previously said, when talking to the FBI, other agents, no, I didn't. I don't know what this is. He authored the thing that was leaked out to the media informing them of all of this. Not only that, but again, I'm going to say it for the third time. When he was testifying about this, him and Comey, they completely conflicted. He lied under oath. And you have jail time that is being suggested for Michael Flynn that was way more hardcore. Michael Flynn's innocent. All Michael Flynn did, if you actually go back and read about it, he was just saying that he didn't remember a certain instance happening. And Peter Strzok, who questioned him, and FBI, they determined that he's lying. So we're going to go ahead and throw the book at you. This is what's so ridiculous. So we've got that. There's a lot to talk about that with McCarthy. And also, let me pull up a couple of other things for you, because it's Valentine's Day, and we have coming up Nevada. There's another debate that's going to be coming up as well next week. The 19th is the debate, and the 22nd is the caucus in Nevada. So next week is going to be crazy. And the other story that I'm very fascinated with is this story with Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez as well. Where she seems to be downplaying Bernie Sanders' effect. And I am made of thoughts on this here. The headline, and this was first over at Huffington Post, where it says the roadblock for Bernie Sanders' agenda. And they're trying to convince Democrats who are not socialists, and I'm not calling them moderates, how they shouldn't be scared of a Sanders presidency. And they went and they interviewed AOC. And she was saying, well, we have to be realistic. She says that, you know, a president can't wave a magic wand and pass any legislation that they want. And she was referencing a couple of different things, his energy nationalization, some of his policy proposals on that, as well as the Medicare for all. And she said that she thought voters understood that there was an inherent check on the president's ability to actually change things like our healthcare system. And she says she's realistic about how far even a President Sanders could actually move Congress. This is her quote. The worst case scenario, we compromise deeply and we end up getting a public option. Is that a nightmare? I don't think so. And she says that that's not our ultimate goal, but that's what we're. This is interesting because I feel like they've had some big discussions behind closed doors and they're trying to. Because this sounds like someone that one of the Pelosi camp or someone who from the, I guess you could say, establishment is reaching out and saying, we got to be let's actually be realistic. And, you know, he's a socialist. And so we need to kind of downplay that instead of working on and focusing on denying the fact that he's a socialist. Let's focus on what of his plan could pass and what couldn't, at least for now. So this is a bit of triangulation. She's trying to say, okay, these are great plans. That's what's suggested. That's the presupposition of her statement. But also, you're not going to be able to get it passed because, you know, we're still going to be able to, we're still going to have people who, we don't control Congress, and the president just can't wave a magic wand and all of this stuff. So this is, I feel like she's trying to triangulate and trying to win over some of the non-socialists in the party to at least consider the idea of Bernie Sanders, because let's be honest, Joe Biden's not going to make it. And I don't think that they're going to be able to pump enough life into Michael Bloomberg, who we're going to talk about here coming up. So that's the other thing that we're watching. We're going to touch on that. The United Nations publishes this anti-Semitic pro-BDS blacklist. My friend Jeff Dunans has this story over at Yid with Lid. And the BDS, which is it's an anti-Semitic targeting of Israel. And you could sit here and say, well, how is it anti-Semitic? Because it's disagreeing with policy. You can disagree with policy all day long. But when the crux of your disagreement is the fact that they're Jewish, that's anti-Semitic. You know, it's not like, oh, we don't like Israel's policy on this. I mean, you can sit here and say, I don't like the way this country is advancing on this or this approach. That's not what their discussion is. Their discussion is, no, they're Jews. That's why we don't like this. I mean, how dare you say that we can? So yeah, that's kind of anti-Semitic. So the BDS is basically about boycotting them out of existence. And the United Nations, and keep in mind that WHO is part of the United Nations. The United Nations, they actually published this blacklist. And it's their Human Rights Council, by the way, on which you have countries on the Human Rights Council that have no idea what human rights are. And the UN called more than 112 companies operating in Judea and Samaria. The UN describing where these companies were located used the phrase occupied territories, and that it was essentially basically a list that's going to help the boycott, divestment, and sanction movement. That's BDS. It was the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights. They identified 112 businesses, 94 Israeli companies, 18 of them call other countries home, including the U.S., Great Britain, France, and Netherlands, and others. And they're targeting General Mills. They're targeting Expedia, Motorola, TripAdvisor, Airbnb. And Mike Pompeo slammed it. He says he was outraged that they even published this list of companies. And they specifically said these are occupied territories. Look at the, this was all designed. And it was, this list was created with the BDS movement and, you know, the resistance. This was all designed to malign these companies. That the whole point of it was to malign these companies. This is what the United Nations, this is what they're going for. This is why people mock the UN. So we've got that. We're also going to open up phone lines. 844-344-DANA. It is Open Line Friday officially. We have a lot to get into. Oh, and then we've got, oh my goodness, what else? The latest with the primary, Rage Against the Machine is now Rage Against the Ticket Price. Oh my gosh, we have a million things, so don't go anywhere. As we move on.
Hi, I'm Dana Lash from The Dana Show. If you could be more heart healthy just by drinking a glass of earthy vegetable juice daily, would you do it? Probably not. But what if this performance-enhancing veggie was transformed into a great-tasting circulation superfood drink? It's called Super Beets, and I can help you try it risk-free. See, Super Beets helps boost your body's nitric oxide levels, and that helps increase your energy and stamina. It supports healthy blood pressure, too. I drink Super Beets in the morning for energy, at the gym for extra long workouts, in the afternoon as a pick-me-up without jittery side effects. Get a bonus 30-day supply free with your first order. Plus, get the book Beat the Odds free and free shipping too. It's guaranteed, or you're going to get your money back. You'll love it.
I immediately felt like I was 10 years younger.
Within, you know, 30 minutes of taking it, I felt a difference.
Call 1-800-892-6790 or go to superbeatsdana.com.
Head to danaradio.com for the latest videos, blog posts, and podcasts.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss.
It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
Yes, it is time for my Quick Five. All right, so we got some on this. HGTV apparently featured its first ever thruple. I'm so tired of this word already. Make it stop. that was on, that was on House Hunters, and they said representation matters. Yes, because probably like 0.024% maybe of people do this. And the other famous throuple couple, they didn't survive. It was called Three's Not a Crowd in Colorado Springs, and the trio wanted to find a new home that would accommodate their unique dynamic. And also a bathroom that had three sinks. And I'm looking at this guy that has two women who are not ugly. And I'm like, what is up with this guy? Is he like a secret billionaire? I don't understand it. Because, I mean, if he like gave me eyes, if I was getting gas or somewhere else, I don't know. I would like maybe call the cops. It's just, he's creepy. I just don't get that. Like, how did these women like this guy? And I'll have something to say to Joy Behar after this, by the way. Because apparently that came up in my name and Megan's name on The View. Moving down. Let's see. Ooh, this is an art critic accidentally destroyed a $20,000 glass installation, and it shattered because she put an empty can of soda on it to show how she did not like the work. And it was at Mexico's top art fair. It was Gabriel Rico's $20,000 piece. And yeah, they ripped the critic, the gallery did, because they said you're a moron. Yeah. Goodbye, women in sports. Goodbye. It was fun while it lasted, ladies, but now we're not even going to be able to compete anymore because a 29-year-old man who identifies as a woman is going to now be competing in the U.S. Olympic marathon trials for a spot in Tokyo. The man goes by the name of Megan Youngren. He's 29. He came out as transgender in 2012. And he's going to be competing to get on into the Olympics. He's going to be among 63 people, all of them women except for him, vying for a spot on the U.S. Olympic team for the Tokyo Games. So, yeah, bye, women. It was nice while it lasted. And last but not least, the Nigerian brothers who Juicy Smollett, like, defamed. They're going to testify against him. Fireworks. Stick with us.
You won't miss any Dana shows by subscribing to the podcast on iTunes, Google Play, or wherever podcasts are available.
Honestly, Brianna, I don't know if I can give you a sense of it. It is to have this horrific black cloud that's been hanging over me and my family for almost the last 2 years. To have that finally lifted is just an unbelievable, it's a relief that I'm not sure I can really explain to you adequately. It's just a very emotional moment for my whole family.
Yeah, well, it's not over. That's Andy McCabe, who's discussing how it's like this black cloud's been like hanging over me, like hanging over my family. You mean like, you know, accusing someone of conspiring? You wouldn't say conspire. They use the word collusion because then they knew they'd get into some trouble if they tried to use a word that was legally actionable. Like accusing someone falsely of collusion and then actually signing off to the extent of is still being investigated, signing off on these requests for a surveillance on people just because of their politics, targeting them and trying to undermine a free and fair election. Can you imagine the cloud that's not only been over members of the administration and their families, people like Mike Flynn, Carter Page. Now, Paul Manafort, I don't like. I've always thought he was a scoundrel. I always thought that. But Roger Stone? The guy, really? Mm-mm. No. But here's the thing. John Durham's report is still coming. While this is the U.S. government saying that they're not going to bring up a criminal charge on this, I hope that you all realize, let me pull this up, that the Durham report, is that supposed to be like later this spring, I believe. And I think that people forget this. Andy McCabe lied a couple of times, actually. He did way worse than what Michael Flynn was ever accused of, and I dare say even Stone. But this isn't completely, he's not in the clear. The last thing on this, there's a Politico piece where they quoted Barr saying that he doesn't expect John Durham, who's a U.S. attorney, his report on the origins of this whole investigation, like what started, what kicked all this off, which is going to look at FISA and everything. This is the report. And I know everyone was talking about the previous one that came out. What was it, like fall, November, maybe October? This is the one that I actually am most interested in because he's looking at the timeline. And Barr doesn't think, he said back in December that he didn't think it was going to be ready for quite a few months. The last that I've read anything about it was that Durham's findings were not going to be complete and made public until maybe perhaps early spring. So the idea that Andy McCabe is in the clear, CNN's contributor is in the clear, I don't think so, because the character, the way that it's been characterized, Durham's investigation, it looks at literally everything. And Andy McCabe is involved in this. So he is, of course, involved in this investigation that Durham is conducting. And the other point to note about this, and this was reported, I think it was originally, I think over at the Hill. But in October, it was revealed that the investigation turned criminal. So it became more than that. This is the Barr report the Durham report that's still, it's still in the works. And I think people are forgetting about this. So we're not done. Andy McCabe is not done yet. And the idea that it should, that somehow questioning how it's acceptable that FBI officials are lying, agents are lying, people who work in the DOJ are lying as so that they can go after and further their motive, further their ambition of targeting somebody over politics. I mean, yeah, I think the Stone thing is a mistrial. It's all garbage. It's all based on lies and political bias. And it's an effort to undermine an election. And the fact that all of the people that are involved in it have contradicted themselves under oath and lied under oath. I mean, if it's not Comey, then it's Andy McCabe. And if it's not Andy McCabe, then it's Peter Strzok. It goes on and on. So don't give me that, well, you know, Stone should go. The process that Stone is involved in is legitimate. It is an illegitimate process. So I reject it outright. It's garbage. It's absolutely garbage. So for this particular situation with McCabe, they were looking at the FBI investigation into him as it relates to the Clinton Foundation and the media disclosure with regards to some of the Russia stuff. But I'm waiting for the Durham, this report. And I know people are still freaking out over the Barr thing. Audio soundbite 14. I just want to play this really quickly. I just don't think that this was, I don't know how this can be classified as blasted or attacks or whatever adjective media wants to assign it. Listen.
Yes. Well, I have a problem with some of the tweets. I'm happy to say that, in fact, the president has never asked me to do anything in a criminal case. However, to have public statements and tweets made about the department, about our people in the department, our men and women here, about cases pending in the department, and about judges before whom we have cases, make it impossible for me to do my job and to assure the courts and the prosecutors in the department that we're doing our work with integrity.
Mm. Well, one other headline too that came about just a little bit ago. Barr is now, he's ordered privately a reexamination of Flynn's case, because they asked U.S. Attorney Jeffrey Jensen of St. Louis. He's tasked with taking a second look at a number of aspects of this case. Several sensitive cases, and one of which is the Michael Flynn case, because they only had him on one procedural charge. And the way that it was reported on, they were questioning him about an incident to which he had responded that he could not recall. He did not remember it. And they accused him of lying. And that's what they charged him with. And keep in mind that it was, I believe, Peter Strzok who was questioning him, the guy who was involved in the text messages, etc. So the here you have Andy McCabe, who did far more. And that he's scot-free. And somebody like Flynn's charged, or that Andy McCabe even knew that this was a BS investigation before they even began this investigation into Stone, and they still did it anyway. This is amazing to me. So, and we're going to talk more about this, because I know that there's some discussions about this even from the left. And I just totally, completely reject even the stuff that I've seen some of my conservative friends write on this. The idea that there's some sort of legitimate discussion to have about Stone and what he did, and he's, you know, horrible and he's a criminal. And again, they were trying to say that he was obstructing a fraudulent investigation. They are trying to say that he was lying to Congress, and They are accusing him of witness tampering when he was talking smack in a text message, which is always, that actually surprised me. Sidebar on this. Stone's been an operative for a long time. And everyone likes to think, and I actually wrote about this in my book, Grace Canceled, which you can pre-order. I love how everyone thinks that certain Republican politicians are somehow faultless and pure as the, you know, fresh driven snow. And it's just not. Everybody had, they did opposition research or dark arts, as people like to laughingly call it. And Stone was that, not just for Nixon, but he was also Reagan's oppo guy. He's been in dirty deeds for a long time. He does opposition research, and there's a lot of things that he would be involved in surreptitiously politically on behalf of certain candidates. And he's done this for a long time. And so as a result of that, he's earned a lot of partisan ire from people specifically because of that. And he's known Trump for a long time. I've known Stone for 10 years now, maybe over 10 years. I introduced him to Jesse Waters. I've had Stone on the show for a long time. Even before I was even syndicated, he came on the show. I first met him in Quincy, Illinois, when this was like in 2008, I think, or 2009, like January, February 2009. I met him in Quincy, Illinois. And I was speaking there for a Tea Party thing, and he was there speaking as well. And we had a discussion about his tortoise shell glasses. I mean, he's a funny dude, and he's very colorful, but at the same time, he's not stupid, and there's not anything that he's going to be reckless about. He's sort of like he's a little bit flashier than James Carville, but he's sort of like. What James Carville is to Democrats is what Stone did for Republicans for such a long time. And he started transitioning out of it, I guess, you know, probably around 2010, 2011, 2012. But he knew Trump for a long time. And there are some Republicans that were involved with working on Trump's campaign. And that's how Stone got back involved with it. But here's the thing. He's not stupid. He's not going to say something, and he knows better than anyone else that you don't sit here and put stuff in print and put stuff in a text unless you're not concerned with it being discussed. I read all those. I had him on the show when their case was ongoing. Didn't they reach out, like the prosecution reached out and was demanding audio from us because they wanted to hear some of his interview to see if he was violating a gag order on specific issues. So they were requesting information from us, and we were laughing hysterically about it. But he was BSing this guy. It was some radio host that I've never heard of who's somewhere in Florida. And Stone was basically like, I'm going to kick your ass. And, you know, what was it? It's like at the end of Unforgiven when Clint Eastwood's like, I'm going to come after you and your dog, too. It was like that, for crying out loud. And they're like, that's witness tampering. I think I also think that some of the Republican and some conservatives posturing on this is just equally stupid. It is. Can you stop for one second? Separate two things here. You can sit here and say that the process through which Stone is being subjected to is legitimate, but the process is only as legitimate as the thing which triggered it, which was this BS witch hunt investigation. Yeah, they're mad at him because he wasn't cooperating with literally an investigation that literally, because I know progressives love this word, was entirely based on fraud. And you're mad at the dude because he wasn't like, yes, let's play ball with your BS false witch hunt, where you're wiretapping and surveilling everyone and spying on them. And you actually didn't abide by the law and the process through which you're going to get a warrant to surveil people through the FISA court because you didn't actually go through the verification process. And then when the investigation on Stone even started, they already knew it was BS. They already knew that everything that was in that whole dossier that they submitted to FISA was bunk. They knew it. And yet they continued anyway. So you're telling me that they're mad at him because he didn't go along with an investigation that was based upon something that everyone on God's green earth had read about in the newspapers that was fraudulent? Tell me about the legality and legitimacy of this process then. This is so stupid. It's like me accusing you me accusing somebody of rape or something, and then you having to go along with this process when I'm trying to ruin your life based on political ambitions. And this is after the evidence is already in any other legal realm would be inadmissible because it's false and fraudulent with no verification, but they still considered it. There is stuff on WikiLeaks that has more legitimacy and more bearing than anything that was in this dossier. And how WikiLeaks isn't even considered credible in a court of law. This is where we are. It's so stupid. So they're like, well, he didn't go along with this dog and pony show. This is why I think it's stupid. I think any conservative or Republican that's even posturing on this, you're literally defending political targeting and abuse of government. There's no other way to put this. And if you're a so-called lover of freedom, you should be up in arms about this. You can sit here and go, well, I think Stone is tacky, and I don't like his Nixon tattoo on his back, and I don't like this, and I don't... Bleh. No one cares about your tastes, okay? Button up. Nobody cares. Nobody cares about your wingtip shoes. Nobody cares about your Brooks Brothers stuff. No one cares about your tastes. But too many people are allowing it to color their opinion on this. It's sad. But, there you go. And then, last thing, because I know we got to get going. The prosecutors, they kept having to kind of like juggle and dance as to how they were going to defend this after all of the information. We're like, why are you still investigating these people? We know the whole entire reason that this got started in the first place is because it's fraudulent. They're like, no, we don't think, well, we think that he lied to us about this fraudulent investigation. That's honestly, that's the argument. Boil it down. That's literally the argument. Well, Roger Stone lied to us about this fraudulent investigation we were lying to you all about. So he's got to get convicted. That's it. End of discussion. Oh my gosh, I will go toe to toe with anybody on this. End of discussion. Anyone who's defending this, you're defending government abuse and targeting people, persecution based on politics. So there's a really good piece over at American Spectator that actually touches on some of this too. Like Manafort, and I know we got to go. I'm sorry. Like Manafort, I've been, you know, like totally straight no chaser about that. The moment he was announced as being a part. And the only reason that they brought Manafort up is because Manafort had experience in dealing with a brokered convention. That was literally the only reason why they were bringing him up, because everyone thought it was going to a brokered convention in 2016, and he stayed on. And I was wary of him from the get-go, because it's like worst kept secret. Everybody knows his record. So that one, he's a little harder to defend. But, man, this is all just ridiculous. We got a lot more in store. 844-344-DANA is the number to call. Our friends over at Caltech.
It's the Dana Show.
Little boomer love song there for you. Why is it all the older family members in my family adore Barry White? What is up with this? Like, I get it. It's a generational thing. I mean, the man is good. I mean, I'm not giving any looks or anything on it, but it's funny because there's like a reverence there. What is that? Y'all know what I'm talking about? Mm-hmm. Like, I remember I said something one time and I had a family member. It was like my great aunt or who, and was like, ooh, I like that Barry White. I like his voice. It's funny, but man alive. And then when we had one family wedding, and you know, when you have like everybody get out there and dance and all that stuff, and you had the father daughter dance and the mother son dance. And then there's a family member of mine. I'm trying so hard not to identify people. It was also their wedding anniversary, which I thought was really kind of also, it was cool. They were married for over 20 years. So, you know, it's not a big thing, but they danced to a Barry White song on the dance. And I had never, and everyone's like, Barry White. And then if you try to talk over it, they're like, shh, it's Barry. Shh. And it's, I don't know. I don't get it. 844-344-DANA. We got a lot in store. Coming up, those Democrat Christmas or Democrat Valentine's cards. Michael Bloomberg is trying to buy black votes. We'll discuss that here coming up. Mini Mike.
The Dana Show.
I'm sorry. Actually, I'm not sorry. I'm not sorry at all.
If you knew the shows that I turned down in order to speak to you, you would be very impressed with yourself, Dana. That I can tell you.
Delivering the truth.
Are you a citizen or are you a subject? Because I'm a citizen, and I'll ask whatever question I want to whenever I want to. If you're a subject, you go on and you be a subject. I'm a citizen.
The Dana Show.
There is one aspect, approach, that I deeply regret. The abuse of a police practice called stop and frisk. I defended it, looking back, for too long because I didn't understand then the unintended pain it was causing to young black and brown families and their kids. I should have acted sooner and faster to stop it. I didn't, and for that I apologized.
Okay, I don't believe you. I don't believe you. I am Will Ferrell in Anchorman. I don't believe you. Welcome back to the show. I'm Dana Lash, at DLash on Twitter, official Dana Lash on Facebook, danalash.com. Sign up for the email subscription list. Pre-order the book, Grace Canceled. It's out in a little over a week. And all 3 hours streaming live, YouTube, Facebook, channel 248 Pluto with the first. I don't believe Michael Bloomberg. And here's why. I want to be clear. I've discussed this, and I'm actually going to write something about this in greater detail coming up. On the website, it'll probably be tonight because I'm crazy. But I have always said that Michael Bloomberg has a behavioral pattern of bigotry. Now there's two things, and there's a lot of nuance here. And I get that nuance is dead and no one wants to have conversations about it. But I think it's important to do that, to unpack this. There is, I think, two different kind of approaches in terms of condemning stop and frisk. And he did zealously defend this for a long time. And I don't think that he regrets it in his heart because of the way he so and attacked people who criticized him on it and defended it so hardcore. And also because he's apologizing for the perception of him being a racist, not for really ultimately what stop and frisk was about. And this is important, especially as there are pundits desperately and operatives desperately looking to see who could take Biden's spot because he's failing. He's like on a landslide now in the polls. Like I said, there's two approaches to this, to the opposition to stop and frisk. The first one is what is being popularly, nationally acknowledged in all of this discussion. And they say that a lot of the criticism of it that I've seen is that it is racial. It is a racist policy. Now, let's take this for a minute and let's break this down even further. As it relates to Michael Bloomberg, and I really direct this to a lot of the conservatives and Republicans out there, some of whom are my friends and continue to be my friends, even though we disagree on this issue, that say it is wrong to call him a racist because of this policy. I disagree with you. As I said, when we were just getting into this, I think that there is a pattern of behavior with him, a bigoted pattern of behavior. Whether it is people who are less fortunate, and we have that audio, I'm happy to play it for you if you'd like, where he discusses how the poor have to be taxed to the point where they have no discretionary income because they use their discretionary income to purchase things that are not good for him, not good for them. He makes these assumptions about people and really disparages them while he simultaneously says it's all because he wants to help. What he says betrays what he says also is his stated intent. There's a dichotomy there. The second thing is, you need to realize the statement that he made. And I say it again, it wasn't just the video that we all have been talking about since 2015, the Aspen Institute, where he hired lawyers to stop it from going out. I wrote about it back in 2015. Daily Caller wrote about it. This is not new audio. And it's not a new statement from him either. That's why there's so many different clips. Some of it is not even from Aspen Institute. Yeah, I mean, you have stuff out there where he said as recently as 2017. And he states that when he's discussing the crime rate, he wasn't specifically talking about New York City because the figures that he was using were misattributed figures that came from FBI uniform crime reports for a 10-year period. I wrote about this actually in my first book. Everything is cited. He was talking about And if he says he was talking about New York City, I don't believe that either, because he's using and misattributing data from FBI uniform crime reports, and he couldn't even properly understand that, which is what I don't understand, because isn't he a numbers guy? I don't get it. What he said is that the majority of young black men committed 93% of the crimes. And he did not break that down. He did not clarify it. He did not, nothing. It wasn't there was no caveat. It was that statement. And he has said that in other instances and also touched on it beyond the 2015 audio. And you can Google it. I mean, it's out there. That's why we have the internet. Yeah, listen to this again real quick.
95% of your murders and murderers and murder victims fit one MO. You can just take the description, Xerox it, and pass it out to all the cops. They are male minorities, 15 to 21. That's true in New York, it's true in virtually every city. Yeah.
True in New York, true in Virginia, true. He says it's true everywhere. Virtually every city. This is where he's wrong. The numbers that he is using for this, you're talking about the 93%, and he says that these men are the ones responsible for most of the crime, and these men are also, you know, they can also be the biggest victims. What he is, and this is so important, young black men are more likely to be murdered by other young black men, and the 93% statistic isn't that young black men are responsible for all of this percentage of crime. It's that the number of young black men who are victimized by other black men, 93%. The way that he's stating it, what does that intimate? He's blaming one demo for everything. Now, you could say this is a mistake, but this is where I have to go back and I look at his overall behavioral pattern. He is condescending and bigoted towards people of lower incomes. He's especially condescending and bigoted towards women who feel the need to defend themselves using their Second Amendment rights, which is why he bankrolls some of the most heinous attacks on women of all political persuasions who simply want to defend themselves with a firearm. All of the nasty attacks that you see from these groups, he pays for that. He bankrolls it. He's bankrolling the people calling your mother, your sister, your wife horrible names because they are law-abiding women who simply want to own a firearm. He bankrolls that. He has no problem with it, and he's well aware of it. And the way that he looks at people who are not of his status. So I use that to inform my perspective of what he's saying here. Is he a racist in his heart? I don't know. Is he a bigot? Yes, you are damn right he is. That is unarguable. And I think that he has a prejudice towards minorities who are armed. Now, when you look at stop and frisk and look at this in conjunction with stop and frisk, whether, and I think that you have to look at the numbers. And I did. I actually looked at the numbers the other night. I deep dove into this. I only touched on this for my first book, but I did a deep dive the other night because I wanted to see percentage of what, break out the demo, and young black men were the ones who were more targeted. And of the 66% of stops that led to frisks, over 95% or something like that. I have it on danalash.com. There was no weapon recovered, and that is what initially kicked this off because they were trying to confiscate and eliminate the carrying of firearms illegally by a specific demo. And there was one demo that ended up in New York City who were targeted more than other individuals. And that's also not really up for debate. It doesn't matter if you're conservative or if you're progressive. And if you're conservative, we always believe that facts matter. And this is why I'm very deliberate and careful in the path that I'm walking down and breaking this down. And I don't think that it is an issue. I don't think that this is a characterization of police, because police are trying to do the best that they can with the tools that they have. I mean, didn't we just talk about Kim Fox in Chicago just the other day, the crooked prosecutor who's only now pursuing the whole Juicy Smollett thing, to quote Chappelle, because she wants to run for office. She has political ambitions, and there was a lot of blowback when she was corrupt and didn't do what she was supposed to do. And you have to look at what we've just been talking about the previous hour. These corrupt agents like McCabe, people like Peter Strzok, people like Lisa Page, these are individuals who are in these positions of authority and enforcement. And I am, you know, a white woman from Dallas, and I'm nervous about diminishment of Fourth Amendment rights. And that's what I think stop and frisk represents. Unfortunately, law enforcement, they don't write these laws, and they're not the ones in the courtroom handing down the sentences. They're not the prosecutors who refuse to or allow these people, repeat offenders, to plea down or just drop the charges altogether. You and I have talked about this extensively. This is why I get really mad, because the police have to take the brunt of this. These are men and women from our communities just like us. We come together and mutually agree that as part of our governance, we're going to pay people to help protect our communities and keep them safe, and that's who these people are. And so I get mad because it feels as though law enforcement, and it doesn't feel that way, it is, law enforcement are having to pick up the slack for corrupt prosecutors and corrupt judges and a judicial rot. We wouldn't even be having this discussion if we actually had a deterrent to stop recidivism and to stop these repeat offenders. And it's the same, I mean, you have a tiny percent of the population that drives the overall majority of the crime. It's true in Chicago and it's true in New York. So that being said, as someone who's a law-abiding gun owner, and as someone who is worried about the diminishment of Fourth Amendment protections and things like red flag laws, so too do I worry about this for stop and frisk. And as I said yesterday, my big concern is that stop and frisk meets the legal definition of search and seizure. That's how it was argued in court. When you read Terry v. Ohio, when you read the Arizona case, there's like a couple of different cases that get into this. And the problem is that if you're going to get a warrant and you're going to search someone's home, you have to have probable cause. But for stop and frisk, probable cause was reduced to reasonable suspicion. And that worries me, because for red flag laws, you have your rights stripped from you by the lowest evidentiary standard. And stop and frisk is pretty much the same logic. So I think there's a disconnect if someone is going after red flags, but yet defending stop and frisk. There are much better ways of combating crime and also increasing deterrence than putting a punching or putting a slight against Fourth Amendment rights. That's the perspective that I come with it. And for Michael Bloomberg to go out there and say, well, you know, I shouldn't have. He leaned into it to the point where he increased the stops by 700%, actually by over 700%. So he leaned into it so hard, I don't buy it. And now he's talking about throwing his money at the black community to think that that's going to make up for everything that he did. It doesn't change his bigoted outlook. We'll talk more about this here coming up, but we have headlines on the way. And Andy McCarthy is going to join us. I'm like made of questions about this ongoing situation with Stone and Barr and everything else. As we move on, Raycon, they are the best wireless. For 40 years, Delta Rescue has provided dedication and everlasting love to animals. Its founder, Leo Grillo, left Hollywood and devoted his life to saving abandoned animals. Delta is the largest no-kill, care-for-life sanctuary in the world. And by being a part of the Delta mission, well, you're the difference between life and death for so many animals. And as a way of saying thank you, Delta is giving you a special gift. Act now and receive a copy of the movie The Rescuer. It's an award-winning documentary about Leo's two-year-long rescue of a family of 21 dogs that were abandoned in the wilderness, and dozens more in the process. The Rescuer is yours free by visiting deltarescue.org/Dana. And for information on Delta's tax-saving estate planning, go directly to deltarescue.org/Dana and ask for my free estate package. It lays out everything that you need to know about growing your estate while letting your compassion for animals live well into the future. And this is only available at deltarescue.org/Dana. So show your dedication and everlasting love and make your legacy work for the animals. Visit deltarescue.org/Dana today.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss.
It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
Fun fact, I had an aunt that danced so hard at that song at a wedding reception, she broke her heel off. like her high heel. Broke it off. I'm not even remotely stretching that story at all. All right. Let's get into it, because we've got Annie McCarthy coming up in a million things right now. Headlines. This just in, and I don't know what the sentencing phase is going to be, but Michael Avenatti was literally, while we were on break, found guilty of all counts in that Nike extortion case. What was that? Do you hear a tiny little basta coming from somewhere out there? He's guilty on all counts, and he showed no reaction as the verdict was read, so now he's a convicted felon, which means he would also be ineligible to lawfully carry or purchase a firearm. I'm curious as to whether or not his sentence is, how that would compare to what was recommended to Stone. So we'll keep, yeah. Colin Kaepernick reveals he is now going to write a memoir on his wokening, and he formed his own publishing house because he doesn't think that literature is diversified enough. Okay, all right, well, there you are. I don't know what this means. This is silly. GOP lawmakers are pushing back on a proposal, including tampons in Tennessee's tax-free weekend, saying that women could purchase too many. What? This is a story. They said that it would allow tampons and other lady products of that lady nature to be tax-free during the state's, you know, the tax-free weekend that everybody has. This is according to AP. Republicans said that people could purchase too much if not given a limit. Again, the problem isn't too few taxes, it's too many taxes. And a man is accused of who was accused of a subway stabbing says that he did so because his victims were aliens. It was in San Francisco, his trial's in Oakland. We got a lot coming up. Andy McCarthy joins us next.
Visit us at caltechweapons.com.
You know,
big Democratic scam for about 7 years. Started in 2011. We're going to reveal the whole thing. It's not just Biden. A bunch of Democrats, and that's why they're so crazy on the subject of Ukraine, and why they want to literally kill me.
What do you mean? Other Democrats are involved?
Well, you go back to 2011, Yanukovych warranted $7.5 billion in an American institution. People in that institution were former Obama aides. That's just one story.
That's Rudy Giuliani discussing the whole situation with Ukraine and those involved, and it goes back to what we've been discussing with Joe Biden, Hunter Biden, and really the role that Giuliani played in all of this as well. I see that this issue, as we've discussed just a bit, has sort of divided the right in terms of the Stone sentencing and also the situation with Andy McCabe. And I'm glad that we have our guest for today is Andy McCarthy, who everyone knows. Andrew McCarthy, a U.S. attorney. You see him on Fox. He's a contributing editor at National Review, best-selling author, and he was the former chief assistant U.S. attorney. He joins us now, and he's been following this and writing some very good pieces on this. Andy, as always, thank you for joining us.
It's my pleasure, Dana.
So. And I've seen that this is even, I want to touch on the Stone thing first, because the sentencing, you've written a really good piece that we actually cited yesterday on this. I know that this issue, it seemingly has kind of divided the right a little bit, where you have some individuals who say, well, he messed up. He's guilty of procedural charges. He shouldn't have done this. He deserves it. He deserves at least to be sentenced. And then you have other individuals who say, well, isn't this entirely predicated upon an investigation that was known to be based on fraudulent means? And it was publicly even known at the time the investigation was going out. So if we're discussing really the integrity of the law, wouldn't that have been compromised from the very beginning and not just when Stone chose to not go along with that? Can you even reconcile those two positions, and what are your thoughts on that?
Well, I think that you can't reasonably have a functioning justice system if you allow people the license to lie to investigators or mislead an investigation on the off chance that, you know, eventually you'll be able to show that what was being investigated was bogus. You know, in order to have a functioning criminal justice system, especially when you're in a country, and a lot of countries aren't this way, when you're in a country where you have the great privilege of being able to tell law enforcement to go pound sand, that you don't want to talk to them, then if you make the decision to speak and to participate in the proceedings, then you have to do it honestly. Otherwise, you should just say, you know, I'm taking the fifth and leave me alone. Mm. So I don't have a problem with the idea both that the investigation was on a bogus premise and that you don't get to mislead the investigation, because if a real injustice is done, at the end of the day, you're supposed to have prosecutors who have discretion not to go forward with the case. And if it turns out the prosecutors are the problem because the whole thing has been politicized, then the president can pardon the guy. Mm. So there are a lot of mechanisms in the system so that when, it's a human system, you can't weed out injustice because we just can't. But there's a lot of fail safes in the system so that if injustice occurs, you can address it.
Which is really ultimately what William Barr did when he learned what the sentence recommendation was, 7 to 9 years, and he countered that. And I agreed with you in because I always assumed that that was within his power to do so. He wasn't. And correct me if I'm wrong on this, he wasn't trying to intervene and somehow undo the conviction. He was just simply suggesting that perhaps maybe the sentence recommendation was a little harsh. He's allowed to do that.
He sure is. And let me just give you a sense of how silly this whole thing is. Neither the sentencing guidelines nor anything that the Justice Department says about the sentencing guidelines are binding on the sentencing judge. There's nothing that Bill Barr or the Justice Department or, for that matter, the four lawyers who, you know, did their Sally Yates star turn and handed in their resignations, right? There's nothing any of them can do to control how the sentence comes out. It's completely up to the judge, and she doesn't even have to follow the sentencing guidelines. She can follow the statutes. He was convicted of 7 counts. If you add up the statutes, it's I think the total exposure is 0 to 50 years. So she doesn't have to give him 90 to 108 months, which is one interpretation of the sentencing guidelines. She doesn't have to give him 37 to 46 months, which I think is Barr's more reasonable interpretation of the guidelines as applied to this case. She can give him nothing. She can give him 50 years, or she can give him anything in between. And there's not a thing the Justice Department can do about it. So they've manufactured this whole controversy over a non-binding recommendation made to a judge who gets input on sentencing not only from the Justice Department but from the defense lawyer and the U.S. Probation Department. So she already knows there's nothing the Justice Department is telling her about the case, which she sat in on the trial of, or the sentencing guidelines. She knows more about it than they do. So this whole idea that he's like somehow controlling the sentence is just absurd to anyone who actually is familiar with how the system works.
Yeah. One of the discussions that I've seen sort of on social media, and I kind of wonder this myself, but not being a lawyer, I mean, clearly, let me know the lay of the land here. Knowing that there were so many questions of legitimacy as to the investigation just in total as it relates to Stone, and I want to get into the latest with McCabe here, too. Is it even possible for him to request a new trial? I mean, could this be declared a mistrial and then all of this has to start over again? How would that even proceed? Does that work?
Well, yes, he can move for a new trial on the grounds that his constitutional right to a fair jury was violated. Mm. And the issues, you know, there'd be a number of issues that would go into that, like how much of this information was available to the defense lawyers. Did the juror lie or mislead people about what her biases were?
Yes.
Is that something that should have been known at the time? And the other thing, Dana, I think that would probably factor in here is that the evidence in the trial against Stone is overwhelming because this guy not only, you know, obstructed the proceeding, he decided he's a, you know, one of these rocket scientists who decides to do it in text messages. So, you know, it was all there for the jury to read, including the threats to the witness, which is why it took about, you know, 15 seconds to convict him at the end of the case. So one of the hurdles he'll have to get over, if it turns out to be relevant, like, did it really make a difference to the outcome of the case that this juror was biased? You know, that's something he'll probably have to address. But look, in this country, we're entitled to a fair jury. And if they can show he didn't get a fair jury, he should get a new trial. I don't know how much it'll help him to get a new trial. I don't know how financially ruined he's been by this whole escapade. And it looks to me like he'd get convicted in the end, but I think he's certainly entitled to move for a new trial.
And you make me think of something, one more thing on this as well, related to this, because this juror who was, you know, the foreman, which is amazing to me because I don't even know how she made it on there. She was very, very vocal on social media. And people have, I mean, obviously, you know, they have their First Amendment rights, and we don't believe that anyone is without political opinion or bias. But is that something that you think is going to come into play at some point? I mean, where is the line on being able to obviously express your First Amendment right and have political opinions, and then having that also be considered by attorneys when they're going through the jury selection process and whether or not someone is disqualified from being on the jury or not? I mean, how is that? Do you anticipate that's something that's going to have to be handled at some point?
Yes, in this case it will, because we now have a juror who may have misled. And I don't want to cast aspersions at the juror, because I don't know if that's what happened. But understanding that we don't know all the facts, if it turns out that somebody misleads you about what her biases are, the fact that she has biases and maybe is a person who should have been disqualified from serving on this jury would not be a violation of her First Amendment rights. We're all allowed to have political opinion,
right?
But you know, there's obviously a certain kind of juror who shouldn't be a juror in this case. That doesn't make the juror a bad person. But like, for example, if you're a Democratic activist who is like every hate Trump rally that comes along, and you're like out there with your signs that say impeach Trump, I hate Trump, Trump is awful. And then it turns out that you get called for jury duty on a case where it involves a friend of Trump who was associated with the campaign that you were, you know, so vehemently against. You're not a juror who ought to sit on that case. And that doesn't mean we're condemning you or telling you that, you know, you're a bad person. I'm, you know, if I got called to jury duty in connection with a case that involved something that I was passionately interested in, mm-hmm. and that if I was being honest, I couldn't say I could be completely objective about, or if it was like a member of my family that was under investigation,
right.
You know, the fact that I have First Amendment rights doesn't mean I'm a suitable juror for that trial.
Right. No, that's
a good look. We got lots of trials. If you want to be a juror, we can find one for you.
Yeah, exactly. Be easy to get one. As it relates to the jury for Andrew McCabe, was it just because the case against him was weak? Is this why there's no charges against him with this case? Or was it that he maybe somehow skated because of his service with FBI? Tell me about this.
I think that we're going to find out that there's more going on here than what we see. I've been going through the Inspector General's report on McCabe for the last couple of hours because I want to write about this. I don't think the case against McCabe was weak at all. I think it was quite strong that he had made false statements. And I accept the fact that, you know, he lost his job, he was fired, he's going to lose at least part of his pension. So it's not like nothing happened to him here.
Right.
He did, obviously, I think he landed on his feet just fine, but Yeah, right. So, but I still think, you know, if you look at how General Flynn was treated, or you look at how Papadopoulos was treated, or these other people who, you know, they scorched the earth to try to nail and ended up, you know, pleading them to false statements counts. And then you see this guy dance away without anything. Then you have to ask yourself, do we have two tiers of justice here where the connected people get away with murder or, you know, at least false statements, and, you know, everybody else has a different quality of justice. If that's all that's going on here, and, you know, McCabe is going to walk away and that's the end of it, I think we got a big problem.
Mm-hmm.
I just saw a report, however, that says that, you know, Attorney General Barr, this has obviously been done under the radar screen,
mm-hmm.
has investigations ongoing into the decision to charge some of these other people, like General Flynn in this case, right, and whether those charges should have been brought. So if this is somehow at the end of the rainbow, what we get to here is this is Barr's way of saying the era of politicized law enforcement needs to be over on both sides, and we're just going to, you know, we're going to lay down our weapons here, and everybody's going to walk away, and we're not going to use the criminal justice system anymore against our political enemies. That would be, I suppose that would be a good development. It wouldn't take away what has already happened to these people. I mean, you know, Flynn lost his house. A lot of these people have
his whole livelihood,
these investigations. And I also don't think that what, you know, I agree with Barr that the criminal justice system shouldn't be used as a weapon, but I have no confidence that the next time the Democrats get in, it won't be.
I know.
So that's, you know, we'll just have to see what they do with everyone.
That's the big question there. Andy McCarthy, we so appreciate your expert perspective on all of this, too, because there's so many of these stories and these situations here with regards to DOJ and FBI flying around. Yeah, it's really hurting people's belief and faith in these institutions, unfortunately. Andy McCarthy, you can find him at andycmccarthy.com, editor at National Review, and go get one of his books. Andy, always a pleasure. Thank you, my friend.
Thanks, Dana. Have a great weekend.
You too. Bye. All right, folks, we have more in store. 844-344-DANA is the number to join the program. Yeah, it doesn't really encourage people's faith in these institutions when here in the span of 1 week, you have Stone, who gets a 7 to 9 year recommended sentence for procedural charges that Andy McCabe is convicted for, well, or charged with. And as you heard Andy say, the case was strong against him. We have the testimony. We were telling you about it. They were on camera doing it. And he skates. I am fascinated by this. So, yeah, I'm curious as to your thoughts as well. And don't forget, we got Mailbag of Hate coming up here in a little bit also. As we move on.
It's the Dana Show.
It's time for Florida Person. It's time to check what Florida is up to.
All right. Okay, so where to start with this? Because it's been kind of crazy. There's one guy who got in trouble because he was messing with a jumbotron. And this story comes by Jacksonville.com. This Florida man, who is a sex offender, was indicted after the Jaguars jumbotron malfunction investigation. A 49-year-old former jumbotron operator. He was indicted because he's a pervert. You know how I feel about that. He faces up to 100 years in federal prison. Why not just execute him? Because that's what should happen with convicted child predators. But he ran the jumbotron. Why does that? That's like, that makes it even worse. And I don't know why. Stick with us. We got a lot.
The Dana Show.
I'm sorry. Actually, I'm not sorry. I'm not sorry at all.
You knew the shows that I turned down in order to speak to you. You would be very impressed with yourself, Dana. That I can tell you.
Delivering the truth.
Are you a citizen or are you a subject? Because I'm a citizen, and I'll ask whatever question I want to whenever I want to. If you're a subject, you go on and you be a subject. I'm a citizen.
The Dana Show.
Now, if I were from Texas, I might say Donald Trump is scared as a cat at the dog pound. But since I'm from New York, I put it this way. We're scaring the living hell out of him. And we're just starting right now.
Okay, so I've got questions. 844-344-DANA. We're going to go to the phones here in a minute. Okay, so we're in Texas, and I've never heard anybody say that. Have you heard anybody say that?
Nope.
Stevie, you heard anybody say that? Well, you're not in Texas, but I've never heard anybody say that in Missouri or Texas.
I've heard scared as a long-tailed cat in a room full of rocking chairs.
I've heard sweating like a whore in church, but I've never heard anything. That's not what...
Scared as a cat at the dog pound? I've never heard that.
Yeah, because there's like animal shelters, or they just... And they have a lot of animals in them, not just dogs. Wow. That's awkward. He's trying to be... Hey there, fellow kids. He's trying to be cool. Kane was asking me on break, well, what audio do you want coming in here? And I was too busy looking at all the memes he's trying to buy. Bloomberg. Welcome back to the show. I'm Dana Lash, at D Lash on Twitter. It's the official Dana Lash on Facebook. So no one says that in Texas. Make sure you pre-order Grace Canceled, because it is coming out in a little over a week. And I have all the information to do it at danalash.com. And while you're there, subscribe to the Dana Radio emails, because all the subscribers last night, we had a drawing and we had two winners for a free signed personalized copy of my new book. And we're going to be doing another one on Monday. That's for email subscribers. Then I'm going to have some radio giveaways coming up later next week as well. So you don't want to miss any of that. Yeah, nobody says that. And my youngest son, well, one of my sons, when he was doing homework and was had to research something, he was getting mad because Bloomberg has all the pop-up ads because he's Texas is part of Super Tuesday. So he's targeting Texas and being like ultra annoying here with all of his ads and stuff like that. So yeah, no one in Texas says this. No. I have not heard this. One of the other things that we're going to have to also address here coming up, there's a story that just hit over at GQ of all places, and I retweeted it, and there have been 40 sexual harassment and discrimination lawsuits brought against Mike Bloomberg by 64 women, and a reporter asks, why is his long history of egregious sexism getting a pass? I'm just saying, hey, if it's a disqualifier for Trump, then it should be as well for Mike Bloomberg, right? That's what I'm saying. 844-344-DANA, the number to join the program. Calling in from Missouri, our friend Chris. Chris, welcome to the show. Happy Friday to you. Thanks for your patience.
Happy Friday to you, and for you, Dana, all the patience in the world. Oh. I've been listening to you now for about, well, over a year now since I've been driving truck, and it because I've never had the time to do talk radio before, but I thoroughly enjoy your views and your output, and you hit the nail on the head more times than a carpenter. Now, I do want to maybe possibly give a little insight, my personal feelings on the Democrats aren't attacking each other in court. And, you know, it's like we've got these, the right wing are going to jail, the left, they're just getting off. And there's 100 different movies out there, and I can't pick a dang one of them out of my head right now. But it's like, you know, like the only one I can think of is the Skulls. And it's like, you do something bad, we're going to record it, we're going to keep it on you, and that way, if you ever go against us, we can go against you. And that's what the swamp has.
Yeah.
They've got this link where everybody is connected in criminal activity. So they're afraid to go against each other. They're afraid to actually do the right thing because they know eventually it's going to bring them down as well.
Yeah, no, I think that's a great point, Chris. I think that's a great point because they know that they're going to implicate themselves at some point. So they have to circle the wagons. I appreciate you calling in, my friend. Thank you. 844-344-DANA, the number to join the program. And looking at some of the DNC stuff, Sanders has built a double-digit in a morning double-digit lead in a morning consult poll. They found his support is at 29%. Biden's is at 19. Bloomberg's is at 18. This is one poll, morning consult, one poll. Yeah, that's it's a little scary. Just going to say it's a little, I don't like any of that. I don't know what they're going to do because they're going to end up with this guy. They're going to end up with this guy as their nominee. And then, which I told you yesterday that I think that they should. And then the non-socialists who are not moderates, but they're non-socialists can work to elect Trump and then they can beat back the socialist wave within their party. But they're too obsessed with power and that's all they want. They just want power. So they're not going to do that because that means they'd have to get over themselves. So I'm just saying here's the other thing. I can't believe I almost forgot about this audio. Couple of odds and ends here as it relates to 2020. Where is Buttigieg trying to speak Spanish? Where's that brilliant piece of audio? Because where was he at? He was at campaign stop and he tried speaking Spanish several times and he's in Vegas. It was bad. Listen.
So much for the chance to join you. Gracias por invitarnos para hablar this evening. And I bring greetings from South Bend.
Hola, muchachos. Friends. Me amo. Hi. That's Pete Buttigieg. Wow, that was so white. That was awkward, wasn't it? Oh, man. And he did it. There's more. We could sit here and play like a string of it because he kept doing it. When you don't, although I would say I think it's better than one of the Castro brothers, at least what I'm told by people in Texas, because they actually say stuff like that, not the stuff that Michael Bloomberg said. That was, don't pander. Man, if you're going to pander, you got to pander good. You know what I mean? You can't just like half butt it. You got to full butt the pander. You know, I figured that was more acceptable than the other one. Mm-hmm. Than assignment. See? Uh-huh. That was really awkward. Hola. May I'm Pete. Oh, man. That was so awkward. Oh, yeah. So, okay. Yeah, the... he's really trying to do well in Nevada. We've got all of this to deal with next week. Can you believe this? We got all of this. We got to deal with all of this next week. I'm not too happy about that. All right. I have to make fun of this also. Let me find this because Rage Against the Machine that I always make fun of just because Tom Morello is just annoying. And back in the 90s, they were really cool. Well, people are raging against the ticket prices. Apparently, the lowest price is $125 for nosebleed. Wow. Let's see how many times I can use my wah pedal. I get so much crap from people because I make fun of Tom Morello. And so it just makes me want to do it more. Yeah, it's in like decent seats are going for like $400. Mm. So what is this? It's like one of those situations where what's that saying? You either die a hero or you live long enough to become the enemy. Yep. Isn't this kind of what this is?
Kind of.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think people will pay it. I think people will pay
it. Oh, of course they will. Of course they will.
To relive their 90s.
Oh, my gosh. That's just not good. I don't know. They don't have any like new music or anything like that, right? I stopped paying attention.
They're still mad at the machine.
Purposely. Though. They're mad at the machine of which they are part. They're mad. We're still mad at the machine, everybody. It's the machine. So in order to take revenge on the machine, we got to have a revolution so that we join it. That's the best way. Just join the machine. You realize how ridiculous this is? You have the Bernie people out there saying, oh, this is bad, and we don't like tyrants, so this is why we need the government to run everything. And also, those people should be the only ones that have guns. None of it makes any sense. Okay, so a few... Oh, my goodness, there's a few other things that I wanted to get in here. Because I feel like Bernie is... He had a warning shot when he was on... MSNBC. What channel is Chris Hayes on? I don't know what the hell channel he's.
That's MSNBC.
MSNBC. Okay. He was telling Chris Hayes that it would be very divisive if a candidate gets a clear plurality but doesn't get a majority of the delegates, and then that person doesn't get nominated at the convention because there's all this discussion that maybe there's going to be a brokered convention, and so he's already firing a warning shot for that. Okay. We're going to see how well that goes because he's kind of telling you like right there where he's at. And as it relates to Bloomberg, audio soundbite 8, he was heckled by someone screaming about stop and frisk. And this was his odd response.
Now, I've never accepted a penny interest, but that doesn't mean we don't need your hope because we do. I hope everyone here will consider giving to the Harris County Democrats. You can do it by texting the word progress to this number. Go wait 1 minute.
Oh, my gosh.
Thank you for making me feel like I'm at home.
Oh, man.
That's worse than Biden, man. You mean because everybody in New York was screaming at you about stop and frisk, too? Good heavens. This guy. The good news about Bloomberg is that he's his own worst enemy. He really is. Like, he will say something stupid. Again, more because he can't help it. That's who he is. Oh, yeah, we do have more. But go ahead. We have.
Hold on.
Oh, I thought you meant like you had some more right now, Kane.
Oh, sorry, no.
Oh, no.
We have the one that you put in.
Yeah, no, never mind. It's all right. That's all right. Yeah. Audio soundbite 9, though. This is Elizabeth Warren, who now, she sees Bloomberg as a threat, and she jumps on the, well, now all of a sudden he's racist. The woman who pretended to be Indian said that the guy who liked to diminish the Fourth Amendment and go after people and also is a bigot is racist. Listen.
I want to point out that video just came out yesterday in which Michael Bloomberg
out for 5 years,
is saying, in effect, that the 2008 financial crash was caused because the banks weren't permitted to discriminate against black and brown people. Averted if the banks had been able to be bigger racists. And anyone who thinks that should not be a leader.
Oh boy. Oh man. Well, the whole situation with the housing industry and or the housing market, remember, banks were told that they had to reduce their criteria for loans, and it applied like across the board, not just to one specific demo. But and then Bloomberg launched, he did this last night. I just want to read the tweet. He tweeted, "Tonight in Houston, I spoke about our Greenwood Initiative. My plan will invest $70 billion in black neighborhoods and create 100,000 new black-owned businesses, because that's what government does, and create 1 million new black homeowners. I want to create generational wealth for black Americans." So he wants, I hope this makes you forget about all the times they threw young black men up against the wall. That's basically what he's doing. Oh my gosh. This is what he does, though. He uses his money. And you know, like people like Lucy McBath and some other Moms Demand candidates, they've defended him on Stop and Frisk. They have. So that's their official policy.
Michael Bloomberg officially has backed away from that by apologizing.
Yeah. Well, he didn't he apologized for the optic of him, and he didn't really apologize totally. He was addressing the optic of him being a racist, not the fact that he was actually going after Fourth Amendment rights. Oh my goodness. All right, we got a lot more coming up. You don't want to miss any of it. We got some hate mail on the way, and we got more calls. 844-344-DANA. I'm going to stop and frisk you this Valentine's Day. Love, Bloomer. I mean, no. All right. In the meantime, CarShield's a great...
Watch all 3 hours of The Dana Show live on Facebook, YouTube, or The First, Channel 248 on Pluto TV.
And now, all of the news you would probably miss.
It's time for Dana's Quick Five.
Okay, so I have a new band name for a group of ornithologists who play Flock of Seagulls covers, and it's called Thug Geese.
Yeah.
Yes. So Parks and Recreation escalate efforts to take back control of a field terrorized by a bunch of thug geese. This comes by way of the Register, UK. They say that these thug geese, literally what they're calling them, a bunch of thug geese are squatting on a field adjoining a community center in Palmer Township, Northampton County. And they said that authorities are concerned about the damage caused to the area by them eating grass and defecating everywhere. And the coyotes were ineffective. The geese landed on them. So now they're rolling out like actual wild dogs. I don't know. That's like their geese police. So they're sicking, instead of coyotes, they're putting border collies out on these geese.
Wow.
Because they're such thugs. Thug life! And followed by whatever sound a goose makes, whatever the hell. All right, move on. This is an insane story and also really depressing. A couple was indicted on involuntary manslaughter charges because they allegedly terminated a pregnancy. But she took medication that she ordered from India, and then they hid the baby's body in a shoebox. Kalina Gilliam and Braden Mull were indicted on one count each of involuntary manslaughter. See, what makes it legal is if they would have done it at Planned Parenthood.
Yep.
We got a lot more coming up. 844-344-DANA.
Missed anything from the show? Subscribe to Dana's Daily Podcast by subscribing on iTunes, Google Play, or wherever podcasts are available.
And every day I'd say, what'd you do? And she'd say, well, I played Scrabble today. And I said, who'd you play with? The housekeeper. Did you win? Yes, of course. And I said, mother, the housekeeper works for us. She's throwing the game to you. She said, that's an outrage. And then she finished by saying, and if you learn to play Scrabble, you'd learn how to spell. I said, mother, at my age, I'm never going to learn how to spell. Anyway.
That's Bloomberg trying to be relatable. Yeah. Welcome back to the show. I'm Dana Lash. 844-344. Dana is the number to join the program. It's Open Line Friday. And, yeah, that's him trying to be relatable. Well, we know when my mother, when she was playing Scrabble with the housekeeper. Wow. That's just like my upbringing, right? I mean, I remember when I was younger and, like, you know, my mother, she'd teach me about different games. And, you know, we would make games out of paper because I was actually too poor to go and actually buy a board game or anything like that at the store. And that was really fun. Yeah, that's...
You didn't play Scrabble with your housekeeper?
No, No. No. We were thankful to have a house.
You didn't play catch with your butler?
Yeah, no, didn't have any. I love the way he tries to be relatable. It's because it's bad. Where's this at? Somebody replied. Greg replied on Twitter because I had retweeted that audio sound. Actually, play that again. The audio soundbite where he says, where Bloomberg's talking about Texas, and he insisted that Texans say something that I literally have never heard of. Listen, if we have it.
Now, if I were for Texas, I might say Donald Trump is scared as a cat at the dog pound.
That doesn't even make sense, really.
But since I'm from New York, I put it this way. We're scaring the living hell out of them. And we're just starting right now.
Yeah, because no one says living hell. No one ever says that. Ha ha ha. I'm original, Mike. I'm not mini. I'm original. Golly. And then Greg responded and said, honestly, you should have said Trump is as scared as a black kid getting thrown against a wall by the cops. Oh. Yeah. You know, Trump were scared. Oh, my gosh. That's actually much more apropos. Mm-hmm. Much more apropos. So, I was looking at, let me actually pull this up real quick, because I was looking at this last night, and then we have the morning consult poll. So Democrats now, there's some Democrats that are now trying to thwart Bloomberg's rise. And this is because he is spending a butt ton of money. I mean, there's no other way to put it. He's spending a lot of money. And there's a couple of pieces about exactly how we're going to talk about that next week, how he has previously purchased elections and his strategy going forward for this, because I think some of it's a quasi Bill Clinton strategy too. But some of the polling for this as well, and looking at Super Tuesday and going to the some of these Democratic state polls, rather nationally, Bloomberg's doing well. He is plus one in Florida right now. So he's got a 1-point lead in St. Pete polls. That's one poll from Florida. Someone said, oh, he's leading in Florida. There's one poll that literally has him plus one. So let's chill for a minute. And in there's not really a lot about some of the South Carolina polling. And I'm going to pull up here really quickly. I'm going to pull up Nevada and look at some of the RCP stuff. So Biden is in Nevada in a number of different polls. Biden is, for Democrats, he's leading. And then he looks, Buttigieg is in, there's one poll in which Buttigieg does well, and he's a plus one, but that was actually taken back in the beginning of January, so I don't know necessarily if that I want to count that. But he's focusing everything on South Carolina. That's his last stand. And there's a great piece over at The Federalist talking about how it's the end of the line for fake, quote unquote, moderates. People who aren't willing to at least verbally embrace the label that describes that best describes their politics. So, yeah. But the interesting rise of Bloomberg, for sure. This, and also, too, how this is going to, I'm curious as to how Bloomberg is going to fare up against somebody like Buttigieg, because he may end up losing some of his shine if Bloomberg wants to fight with Trump as much as possible. He doesn't want to be seen as fighting with the other candidates. He wants to continually pick fights with Trump. And Trump needs to realize he can't attend every fight to which he's been invited, because he will inadvertently boost Bloomberg, which is what he's wanting. And Bloomberg is spending hundreds of million dollars. Remember when he was doing a $300 million, something, an insane ad buy? And these are all in Super Tuesday states, because he's just trying to buy it. He goes in and he gives quote unquote grants to all these different groups, and then in turn they come out and they'll endorse him or they'll defend him and all of that. I mean, when you look at, just for instance, in Virginia, all of those candidates who complain about out-of-state money took a lot of money from Michael Bloomberg, and they really pushed gun control. This is what he's doing. He wants to buy his way in and buy the appearance of popularity. I mean, buying influencers, buying up people to make memes. I mean, it goes on and on and on. Yeah. So the 2020 Democrats are trying to thwart this. Elizabeth Warren and Joe Biden, particularly. We played some audio for you of Elizabeth Warren just a little bit ago. And Biden had said, and he said this before, he said it when he was on The View yesterday, and he said it a couple of other times on the campaign trail, no, I don't think that you can buy an election. And Tom Steyer, who is also a billionaire, is trying to position himself as being better than Bloomberg, because he just went right out and kind of echoed what Warren was saying and called Bloomberg a racist. Warren's got to be careful with that attack, because that can be used against her. But she's on such a quick slide. I don't think anything. And have you heard anything more about Amy Klobuchar, by the way?
Just that she's still in it.
Yeah. But that's the whole point. You haven't heard anything. She doesn't pick fights with everybody like everyone else does. And I think she needs to.
She tried with the Sanders stuff. Like, she went out there and talked about socialism and how.
But she, like, didn't pick a fight with him. I mean, she said that, and then James Carville came out and totally stole her thunder.
That's what I mean. Everyone else says the same thing.
She's like, well, you know, I don't think so. And then Carville comes out. He's a damn communist. And so everyone, so she lost that. She lost some of that momentum, because I think he came out, not intentionally, but he stole her thunder a little bit there. She needs to fight with people. But at the same time, I think that her camp is worried about her being, and I'm just going to say it because this is how they tried to do her in, like, in the beginning. I think that they're worried about her being typecasted as a bitch. Because she got, remember, she threw a binder that was, like, right when she got into the primary. There were these stories out. She threw a binder, and then she got mad because she didn't have utensils to eat a salad, so she used a comb. Did you hear about that? Yeah. Okay, well, I mean, I'd rather take a bee than a communist, I guess, you know, if that's the way it is. But, yeah. So you have a bunch of white people. Two of them are Democrats. That is the reality of the Democrat primary. And then we have on the 19th, is that Thursday? No, Wednesday, Thursday, right?
The 19th.
Because the Nevada caucus is Saturday. And so the 19th, yeah, so the 19th is Wednesday. So that's when the debate will be. The debate in Nevada is going to be that Wednesday of next week. And then on the that Saturday, they're going to have the Nevada caucuses. And then afterwards comes South Carolina. Hoo boy. And then March 3rd is Super Tuesday. And that's, I think, when you're really, if Michael Bloomberg is going to be a serious contender, because right now it's just speculative. He has to make big moves for Super Tuesday. That's where he's got to have really big moves on Super Tuesday. So that's where it'll come in. And I think he's going to get really just. There's going to be an onslaught of attacks. So in the meantime, Eric Swalwell is saying maybe we should impeach Trump again. I don't think so. And while he's doing that, there was a story of a 15-year-old, did you hear this? Who was attacked by a 34-year-old man. Because why? This comes by way of the New Hampshire Union Leader. Because the kid was wearing a MAGA hat. Windham, New Hampshire. Police arrested a man accused of assaulting three people in a Trump tent outside the Windham High School, their polling station, as he left the building on Tuesday. His name's Patrick Bradley. And he was charged with three counts of simple assault, a Class A misdemeanor, one count of violation level of a disorderly conduct from the Windham Police Department. So as he was leaving the polling station about 6 p.m. on Tuesday, he, according to police, slapped a 15-year-old across the face as he was passing a Trump tent occupied by Trump supporters and some of the campaign workers, right? It was the primary. And then he proceeded to assault two other individuals, adults, that tried to intervene and stop him from hitting this 15-year-old. And the boy's mother, Kathy Campbell, said that she wants her son to remain anonymous because, yeah, I would too. I mean, hell, this is like the third situation in a week. And she said her son stayed home from school on Tuesday for a doctor's appointment, and they drove by the high school to go and vote. And she said when they got there, they saw Trump Jr. and Kimberly Guilfoyle. And he was over the moon. And she said that, and apparently, I guess Donald Trump Jr. called him after this came out. And Jr. said, he tweeted that he had met the 15-year-old victim before he was attacked by a leftist. So after him and Guilfoyle left, that's when this guy came out of the polling station. And she said that Donald Trump Jr. had called him later on. Afterwards, because the kid obviously was shaken up. So the 34-year-old grown man, Patrick Bradley, he was held at Rockingham County Jail on $5,000 bond, and there was an administrative hold for a probation violation. So today he's being arraigned. This is insane. How many times does this have to happen? Because you had the guy who used his cane sword against Trump supporters just a couple of days ago. And then last weekend, the guy drove a weird poo colored van into a group of Trump supporters in the parking lot of a Walmart. It just keeps happening. And just because of a hat. In my book, Grace Canceled, I have an entire chapter that talks about all of these reactions. And I have so many examples of people being assaulted just for wearing red hats, like people who weren't even talking to them. They had no idea that the people who were about to hit them were even there. They were minding their own business. Like, there wasn't like any mouthing off or nothing. They just are attacked. One guy was attacked from behind and knocked down on the ground, and it broke his new, he had like a iPod player. He was just became a citizen of the country, and he was beaten in the street because of his hat. Unbelievable. But his tweets. And one other last quick thing. If you look at 538, I think that they're getting closer. They're trying to predict an open or brokered convention with DNC. Dang. I would not want to be there covering that. No. Would you?
No.
How do you think that's going to go down? I think that Bernie Bros would riot. I really am not even exaggerating. I think that they would. I think things would be set on fire. I really do think that.
I think the videos we saw from Project Veritas, I think that's enough to where, yeah, you know what? Your theory is probably right.
Whoo, my goodness. All right. Two quick things. DanaLash.com, subscribe to the emails. We're doing another giveaway on Monday for email subscribers that I do live on my Facebook page, Official Dana Lash on Facebook. But also, go and pre-order Grace Canceled. It is a very personal book. I pitched this in 2017 and I went with Regnery that I always wanted to work with. And it is, while it's still a political book, it also is faith-based, and it gets into the breakdown of and really refusal of grace and refusal to even allow redemption, not just politically, but culturally. And I get into some of the history of the violence of the left and how we got to this position where we have Trump as president, how we still have people who insist on television they don't understand how we got to this point. And I even get into social justice warriorism that is in the church. There's a lot in there, so you're going to want to pre-order it. It comes out on February 25th. I know we got to get moving because we're running out of time.
A higher caliber of talk. Get Dana on demand through iTunes or wherever you get your podcasts.
At Dana Lash on Twitter. Official Dana Lash on Facebook as well. As we roll into another weekend, happy Valentine's Day to everyone. I shared a little meme kind of, sort of the one that I guess Bloomberg hasn't purchased yet on Facebook. So for a happy Valentine's Day. All kinds of good stuff. I hope everyone has a good and safe evening as well. And next week we're going to be getting into, because we got that debate, we got Nevada. But honestly, everything is just going to kind of be waiting and sort of speculative up until March 3rd. Because Super Tuesday is when it gets serious. Because right now we can make fun and we can, you know, joke and do all that stuff. But honestly, Super Tuesday is when it'll get serious. Because you got a ton of different states then. And that's going to be a busy, busy day. And we're going to break all of it down for you. Make sure you pre-order your copy of Grace Canceled and sign up for the email subscriptions at danalash.com. Today in Stupidity Game.
All right. Joe Biden was out there defending Hunter Biden. And the stuff we know about Hunter, like getting kicked out of the Navy because of his cocaine problem and laying down with his dead brother's wife, stuff like that. But Joe still got love. Still got lots of love for the son.
Nobody has said he's done anything wrong. This is a guy who has done nothing but good things his whole life. My son, and ran the food program USA, and a whole range of things. But look, it's what it is.
It's what it is.
Yeah, it is all right.
What it is, everybody.
Yeah.
So yeah, no, Hunter hasn't done anything wrong his whole life.
He never. Nothing. I never done anything wrong.
So that's what it is. I guess you just become a head of a food program and. Everything you've ever done goes away.
There you go, right?
And
there.
You have to be Democrat. Forgot about that.
Yeah, don't forget that too.
That's an important part there.
Folks, that does it for us today. Happy Valentine's Day to you and have a fantabulous weekend. And don't forget danalash.com. I'll be sending up the weekend wrap up here later on this evening to get you all set as we slide into Saturday. And then Monday, we start anew. God bless. danalash.com. Pre-order your copy of Grace Canceled today.